Today our scripture comes from 2 Timothy chapter 1 and chapter 3. He was a man who was letting go of his life. He sat in a jail cell, resembling more of a dungeon than a cell. It was poorly lit. It was cold and damp. He was chained to the wall and waiting to die. His execution was imminent, and he was lonely. As his thoughts began to wander, they centered on his close friend. His friend had been more like a son to him, really, and they had shared many experiences, both good and bad, together. The last image he had of his friend was him weeping. His friend had been so saddened by his departure that he didn't want him to leave. Now, as he sits in his cell, he too longs to see his friend once more. He sits down and decides to write his friend a letter. It would be a letter in which he would pour out his heart. He'd pour out his heart to his friend, telling him how much he loved him, encouraging him, building him up, and informing him that he is now in charge of the work they had shared together. It's time for his friend to take over, and the work must not fail. The man writing the letter is the Apostle Paul. His friend is Timothy. 2 Timothy is a dynamic letter. It's authentic and genuine. Paul had recently been arrested in Rome under the orders of Emperor Nero. During Nero's reign as Emperor of Rome, he took great delight in persecuting and killing Christians. Nero would be responsible for the deaths of both Paul and of Peter. His letter is written shortly before Paul's death. So often we hear of people saying they never got the chance to tell somebody that they loved him. They never got the chance to tell them how much they cared before they died. Paul wants to make sure that he tells Timothy everything that's on his heart while he still has a chance. More than anything, the letter of 2 Timothy is a changing of the guard. Paul passes on the torch of ministry to Timothy. One of the great spectacles of the Olympic Games is the passing of the torch. Every 2 years, we either have the Summer Games or the Winter Games, and thousands of people take the opportunity to run with a torch and pass it on to another until it reaches its final destination. The passing is symbolic. One person has fulfilled their duties and responsibilities, and now those same duties and responsibilities are passed on to the next person, and so on, until it finally reaches its destination. Paul has finished his turn of carrying the torch of the gospel of Christ. In chapter 4, verse 7, he says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Now it is Timothy's turn to carry the torch and finish his leg of the race. Today we're going to take a look at how to be most effective for God's kingdom. Paul's words to Timothy were filled with principles and sound, proven advice on how Timothy could be the most effective leader and disciple, the most effective that he could be. Like Timothy, we're currently taking our turn at running with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're carrying the torch. We need to hear Paul's words and apply them to our lives so that we can be effective in God's service. Let's read together 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, in keeping with the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power and love and self-discipline. Our emphasis this morning centers around Paul's words in verse 6, in which he tells Timothy to fan into flame the gift that he's received from God. Scholars have debated on what this gift was, and it's been commonly accepted that Timothy had the gifts of ministry. He was capable of starting churches of teaching, preaching, and evangelizing. Paul's message to Timothy is to fully express his gift, not to hold anything back in his work for Christ. Paul encourages Timothy to fan into flame his gift of ministry in three ways. First, by drawing on his heritage. We all have a heritage. Finding our personal heritage is really pretty interesting. With websites like Ancestry.com, anybody ever tried that? Every once in a while, especially around the holidays, they'll let you try it for free. I did it once, found a few things. It's pretty interesting. We can trace our families back to where they originated, knowing the careers they worked and the lives they lived. Our ancestors continue to shape our lives even today. We bear the name, our last name is the name of our ancestors, and our health is connected to our ancestors. You know that when you go to the doctor, they ask about your family history, right? Our family heritage gives us a complete picture of our identity, who we are, where we're from. You have been doing this through your adolescence. You have been trying to discover your personal identity. And you'll continue to do that as you look forward to your future. For most young people, the single biggest question on their minds is, who am I? As you graduate, you have some idea. When you were a freshman, you had less of an idea. When you were younger, even less. When you were asked what you wanted to be when you grow up, when you were five, are those the same answers they are today? Sometimes they are, but often they change. Likewise, as Christians, we all have a spiritual heritage as well. Our spiritual heritage consists of the people that introduced us to Christ and have helped us to mature in our faith. For some, our spiritual heritage may be linked to a specific church or a minister, a Sunday school teacher, maybe even a youth worker. It may be linked to a teacher or a friend, or as in Timothy's case, his spiritual heritage is linked to his actual family. Paul gives us a glimpse into Timothy's spiritual heritage. It says, I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Timothy grew up in a house of faith under his mother and his grandmother. Both Timothy's mother and grandmother were Jewish, while Timothy's father was a Gentile. It was his mother and grandmother who taught him about God. See, in Timothy's time, it was common that until the age of seven, a Roman boy's mother was to be the most formative in their years. It was likely that Timothy's father, being a Gentile, had very little influence in his religious beliefs. In Judaism, it was customary that boys without a religious living father learned about the law from their grandmothers if they were still living. What Paul is reminding Timothy is that he comes from a great family of faith. His mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois were great women of faith. Paul sees that Timothy has followed in their footsteps. Timothy needs to draw on his heritage of faith for strength and guidance in order to carry the torch of ministry that is passing on to him. So who makes up your spiritual heritage? Who was it that helped you form your faith? Can you still go to those people in times of decision or crisis? Are they still active in your faith development today? Even more important is, whose spiritual heritage are you a part of? Or whose spiritual heritage will you be a part of? Whose life are you impacting? Besides Timothy's mother and grandmother, Paul made up a huge part of Timothy's spiritual heritage. So much so that Timothy is referred to by Paul as my dear son in verse 2. It's a spiritual heritage that will help Timothy fan into flame his gift for ministry. Secondly, developing his God-given gift is a way that he can fan that into flame. In order for Timothy to fan into flame his ministry, he must draw on his spiritual heritage. He must also develop that gift. Paul recognizes and encourages him to develop his gift in verse 6. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying out of my hands. The words fan into flame that Paul uses here can also mean to rekindle or to stir up. The gift that God has given Timothy is like a fire that's burning down deep inside him, maybe only smoldering at the time. But But Paul wants Timothy to develop this gift, not to waste it. Paul wants Timothy to intensify the fire that's in him. Paul wants him to be overcome with passion for this gift that God has given him and use it to its fullest potential. I have a friend who lives in Colorado, and out west, they have forest fires quite often. You wait and see, this summer there will probably be another big forest fire out west. Unless you know somebody out there, often it's easy to just let that go in one ear and out the other when it comes on the news. But these forest fires are huge. This friend of mine, last year, the forest fires were close enough that they were alerted that they may have to evacuate. He could see the smoke from his house. There was huge miles and miles swath of a forest fire. And out west, they have a fire code that helps them distinguish the fire danger of the day. The WIMS is the Weather Information Management System. It collects various data and issues these ratings every day. A low risk is coded by the color green. A moderate risk is alerted by the color blue. High risk by the color yellow. A very high risk, meaning that conditions are very ripe for fire to start and spread quickly, are indicated by the color orange. And an extreme warning is issued when conditions are present for a fire to start quickly and spread furiously and burn intensely. This is identified by the color red. We do have a similar system here in Michigan. Maybe you've seen these at the state parks and around. Paul wants the fire in Timothy to be extreme. He wants a code red. He wants Timothy to develop his gift and fan it into flames to the point where through Timothy, the gospel spreads furiously and its followers burn intensely with a passion for serving Christ and accomplishing his mission. 1 Corinthians 7, verse 7 says, "But each of you has your own gift from God. One has this gift, another has that." The Bible tells us that we are all gifted, just as Timothy was gifted. Are you developing your gift? Do you even know what your gifts are, your spiritual gifts? If you don't, I encourage you to find out. If you've never done that before, I've got spiritual gifts, surveys, inventories that'll help. That's not the only way, but it's a good way to get started. Know your spiritual gifts. Once you discover it, do everything in your power so that that gift is fanned into flame and you use it for the service of God. Make it so that it burns so intensely in your heart that you can't help but exercising it every day. Don't waste what God has given you. You have to exercise it. Just like muscles, right? If you're like me, you atrophy. If you work out, your muscles get stronger. And the same is true with our spiritual gifts. You have to work out, use them, exercise them, round off the edges, round off the corners. Make sure that they work well. And the more you use it, the more you practice, the better you'll be. Don't atrophy. Don't let your spiritual gifts turn into mush. The third way Paul encourages Timothy to display it, the third way Paul encourages Timothy is to display a spirit of godliness. Timothy has the gift of ministry. It was given to him by God through the laying on of Paul's hands. And Paul has instructed Timothy to fan into flame that gift by drawing on his spiritual heritage and developing his God-given gift. Now he instructs him to display a new spirit of godliness. Timothy was known for having a spirit of timidity. He was shy and sensitive, and we've already talked about the fact that he wept earlier on when he left Paul. Paul reminds Timothy that God has given him a new spirit. "For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-discipline." In order for Timothy to fan into flame his gift and assume the responsibility of the ministry that Paul is leaving him, he would have to take on a spirit of godliness. The spirit of godliness consists of three different areas. First is power. Timothy would have to take on a more authoritative role and rely completely on the power of God to sustain him through this time. This would prove to be difficult because of Timothy's age. He was probably in his early to mid-30s. Some think Timothy was younger. We're not sure, but yet Timothy was considered a youth, no matter how old he was. He was considered a youth in the faith. This probably is why Paul wrote the words to Timothy in 1 Timothy 4:12. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are strong or because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Secondly, love. The Bible declares that God is indeed love. He has given every believer his spirit of love. God's love for man is so great that it drove him to send his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for our sin by dying on the cross, to be our sacrifice. God doesn't hold anything back for the world he loves. And Timothy must take on that same spirit as he fulfills the ministry. Thirdly, self-discipline. In order to use fully his gift of ministry, Timothy has to be like the Karate Kid. He has to maintain a high level of discipline in order to apply himself to keeping the fire burning inside him. He's going to have to continually stoke the fire and keep it burning brightly and intensely. Left alone, the fire will burn out. We have to continue to come back to the source of our fire, the source of that spiritual nourishment. But we have to take an active role too. We have to fan the flame, as we read here. We're no different than Timothy. We must also take on the spirit of godliness that Paul describes here. The word that sticks out in verse 7 is the word us. For the spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power and love and self-discipline. The same spirit that was given to Paul and Timothy has been given to us as well. We must exercise our gifts with the power of God, the love of God, and the self-discipline that comes from God. Paul's writing to Timothy and encouraging him to carry on. The torch has been passed. Timothy must use his gift of ministry and persevere if the church is going to survive and grow. One writer, Craig Keener, writes that the letter was preserved, that is 2 Timothy, most certainly indicates that Timothy did persevere. So the fact that his book, the letter, was preserved, indicates that Timothy did finish his work, that he did persevere. So how can we be effective Christians? How can we fan into flame the gift that God has given us by drawing on our spiritual heritage, developing our God-given gifts, and displaying a spirit of godliness? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 through 17, Paul gives this final charge to Timothy. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings, what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you have learned it. And how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You have been equipped. You are being equipped. Fan the flame. Make it your own. The torch is being passed. Run with it. To quote that great song by Rhett and Link, "You're on your own. Good luck." But really, you're not on your own. You have your spiritual heritage. You have the family and friends around you. You have this church. You have the friends that you've made. You have people that you don't even know yet that will encourage you and equip you. Utilize that. fan the flame. Let us close in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you that you don't give us a spirit of timidity, but one of power, of love, and self-discipline. We pray that the words written by the Apostle Paul to Timothy might be an encouragement for us as we seek your will. We pray especially for the graduates this Sunday, but we ask that you would make us all more attuned to attending our own flame. Rekindle the fire you have placed in us. Give us the courage to fan the flame and use our gifts for you and your glory. We love you, Lord, for all that you are, all that you do, and all that you give. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to pay for our sinfulness, that we might be truly forgiven of our sin. May we live our lives in thankfulness as living sacrifice for you. And it is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.